This conference will now be recorded.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Audible, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. Today's class is on polycystic ovarian syndrome. So originally, polycystic ovarian syndrome was described by Steen and Leventhal, and therefore it is called as Steen and Leventhal syndrome also. It is characterized by excessive androgen productions mainly by ovaries. So it is characterized by hyperandrogenism mainly by ovaries. Incidence goes from 4 to 12%, affecting the reproductive age group of people. What Steen and Leventhal done was, like, they described 7 patients. They took 7 patients with amenorrhea, hyperandrogenic features like hirsutism, with enlarged polycystic ovaries, and they reported the results after bilateral wedge resection. Wedge resection means removing a part of ovary. Either half or 3/4 of each ovary is removed from these 7 patients. And after wedge resection, all the 7 patients have resumed their regular menstruation, and out of which 2 of them became pregnant also. Therefore, from these 7 patients, they described polycystic ovarian syndrome, which will be characterized with hyperandrogenism. So polycystic ovarian syndrome is also called as Steen-Leventhal syndrome. It's a common endocrinopathy which is characterized by oligo-ovulation or anovulation with signs of androgen excess and multiple small ovarian cysts, which can be picked up on imaging modalities like ultrasonography. Characteristic polycystic ovary usually develops only after chronic anovulatory state, and if it persists for a sufficient length of time. So when you see a polycystic morphology or polycystic picture on ultrasonogram, don't come to a conclusion that it is a polycystic ovarian syndrome, because it may be functional also without any specific defect. So coming to the differences between PCOS, that is polycystic ovarian syndrome, and polycystic ovaries. See, polycystic ovarian syndrome, it is a endocrinopathy, as we have already said, which is characterized by ovulatory dysfunction, depicted as oligo-ovulation or anovulation, and increased androgen excess or hyperandrogenism, which may be clinical or biochemical, and after exclusion of other endocrinopathies. You have to exclude all other causes which will cause ovulatory dysfunction and hyperandrogenism. Polycystic ovarian morphology is the presence of multiple ovarian cysts of size 2 to 9 mm in diameter or increased ovarian stroma. This condition may not be polycystic ovarian syndrome or pathological. It may be even functional. Therefore, by seeing an ultrasonograph picture of polycystic ovaries, you cannot come to a conclusion or you cannot diagnose the patient as PCOS. So what is the diagnostic criteria? Then how you will diagnose the PCOS? So Estray and ASRM, ASRM is Estray and ASRM from Rotterdam 2003, have given this diagnostic criteria, which currently we are following. Out of 3, any 2, if it is positive, then you will go for PCOS. The 3 criteria are clinical or biochemical hyperandrogenism. Clinical means if she have any symptoms of excessive androgens, or biochemically, if she has increased testosterone or androgen levels on blood investigation, then also you can consider. And if she gives you the history of oligo or anovulation, or the third one is ultrasonogram picture showing polycystic ovaries, that is 2 to 9 mm diameter size of cyst of more than 12 in number, or ovarian volume of more than 10 cm cube or 10 ml. So any two, if at all it is positive, then it is diagnosed as PCOS. So coming to the etiology of PCOS, nothing is proven, like lifestyle changes, dietary factors, stress, obesity, even genetic factors and environmental factors, all will confluence to form the etiology of PCOS, but nothing is strongly proven that PCOS is because of this cause. So mostly it is unknown. So pathophysiology of polycystic ovarian syndrome is explained under the following headings, like hypothalamic pituitary, androgen excess and ovulation, obesity with insulin resistance and the other long-term consequences. So the pathophysiology, particularly it starts from hypothalamic pituitary system. In hypothalamus, there is increased frequency of GnRH release. Generally, this gonadotropic releasing hormone is usually released in a pulse fashion. It is not continuously released. Therefore, this pulse frequency is increased. So more number of times this GnRH is getting released from hypothalamus and it is stimulating the pituitary. So when this pulse frequency of GnRH is increased, it preferentially stimulates luteinizing hormone. Pituitary is having gonadotropes, LH and FSH. LH is luteinizing hormone, FSH is follicular stimulating hormone. With increased pulse frequency of GnRH, there is preferential stimulation of LH. Thereby, it increases the frequency and amplitude of luteinizing hormone. So finally, you can see here, LH is increased, FSH is decreased because hypothalamus increased pulse frequency of GnRH increases LH pulse frequency, and thereby LH is increased and FSH is decreased, and ratio of LH to FSH also increases. So these gonadotropes act on ovaries. How they are acting? With increased in LH, ovarian theca cells get stimulated and they produce androgens. And with decrease in FSH, FSH usually it will have an effect on granulosa cells. As you all know, ovary will have granulosa cells and theca cells. Theca cells usually they will produce androgens, and granulosa cells are meant for aromatization. Aromatization is estrogen synthesis from androgens. Once the androgens are synthesized in theca cells, they go to the granulosa cells and they complete the aromatization and estrogens are formed. Thereby, reduced FSH levels will reduce the maturation of various follicles in the granulosa cells, and reduced aromatization will decrease the concentration of estrogen as well. So LH stimulates the theca cells with excessive production of androgens, and FSH will reduce the follicular maturation and decrease the aromatization and decrease the estradiol levels. That is hypothalamic pituitary pathophysiology. Coming to androgen excess, the principal sources of androgens are from ovaries, adrenals, and systemic metabolic alterations. Ovaries due to LH stimulation, as I've already said, LH stimulates the theca cells of ovaries and it produces excessive androgens. And due to this hyperfunction of P450 enzyme also. P450 enzyme is a regulatory enzyme for the synthesis of steroid hormones. And decreased aromatization. Ovarian aromatization is decreased because decreased FSH concentration. Thereby it increases the androgens. There are three factors: increased LH, increased function of this enzyme, and decreased aromatization. From adrenal, major androgens are from ovaries, but mild increase in adrenal androgens also can be seen. This is also due to hyperfunction of this enzyme, which is a regulatory enzyme for steroid hormones, and high stress levels and high prolactin levels. You can see this ovary, LH stimulates the theca cells of ovaries and directly it produces the androgens, androstenedione and testosterone. And this enzyme, P450 enzyme, which is a regulatory enzyme for steroid hormones, this hyperfunction of this enzyme also increases the androgens. Decreased aromatization. Aromatization means conversion of androgens to estrogens. When this is decreased, estrogen levels decreases and androgen level increases. Even in insulin and insulin like growth factor also stimulates the Pica cells of ovary, and they also contribute to the increased levels of androgens. The metabolic alterations are in hyperinsulinemia. Hyperinsulinemia is due to insulin resistance. Insulin resistance causes increased insulin levels, and those insulin levels along with insulin like growth factor, they stimulate Pica cells and increases the androgen concentration. Even sex hormone binding globulin synthesis is reduced due to insulin, which is actually meant for transportation of these androgen hormones. If this sex hormone binding globulin is reduced, free androgens are increased, and hyperprolactinemia. See, these androgens from ovaries and adrenalines, they undergo peripheral aromatization. It is not the aromatization which we have already mentioned in the ovary. Ovarian aromatization is reduced. Peripheral aromatization, that is from the fat cells. These androgens which are produced, they go to the adipose tissue and they are converted into E1. This is estrone. This is not estradiol, estrone. In ovaries, androgens usually get aromatized to estradiol, that is E2. From adipose tissue, androgens are converted to E1. Therefore, E1 levels increases. And when this androgen increases, and due to hyperinsulinemia, serum sex hormone binding globulin decreases. Thereby, the remaining androgens are increased and unbound estradiol is increased. Therefore, two pathophysiology we have already seen, that dysregulation of hypothalamus pituitary and hyperandrogenism. Why this anovulation causes? Because low levels of E2 levels, as I've already said, ovarian aromatization of androgens will produce E2, that is estradiol. Please remember, estradiol is E2, and increased inhibin levels in the ovary reduces the FSH level because of negative feedback mechanism. In this picture, you can see increased estradiol and increased inhibin have negative feedback effect on FSH. Thereby, FSH is reduced in the ovaries. Low E2 levels and increased inhibin levels reduce the FSH levels by negative feedback mechanism. Thereby, FSH is actually essential for the follicular growth. So when the FSH levels are low, the follicular growth is arrested at various stages, like 2 to 10 mm size of cyst sizes. And there is defective ovarian aromatization of androgens. Androgens doesn't get aromatized into estradiol. This is one feature, and the elevated LH level in the ovaries. Decreased FSH causes arrested follicular growth, and elevated FSH causes hyperandrogens. And completely the ovarian environment will become androgenic. So finally, for ovulation, the ovary should have an estrogenic microenvironment, and there should be a LH surge for the ovulation to occur, which is absent in PCOS. If you see, for any ovulation, the follicular growth should be there along with LH surge. LH surge is prior to ovulation, there is peak elevation of the LH. But in PCO, if you see, there is a constant elevated level of LH without any peak. Thereby, there is no LH surge, and even the environment or microenvironment in the ovary is more of androgens, which is not in favor for ovulation. Therefore, in PCOS, you will see an ovulation. So most of the PCOS patients are obese. Even you can see lean PCOS also. Obesity, usually obese patients or obese women will have increased insulin resistance. I'll talk about insulin resistance in the later slides. Due to insulin resistance, there is high serum levels of insulin. When there is high serum level of insulin, it will go to the liver, and it will reduce the sex hormone binding globulin. When this sex hormone binding globulin is reduced, there is increased total androgens. And the same insulin, it will, as we have already seen in the other picture, it will stimulate the theca cells and it will produce androgens. Finally, due to hyperinsulin, androgen levels are increased. Insulin resistance, it is a condition in which either endogenous means the insulin which is produced in one's own body, or exogenously administered insulin which is given from outside, will have a less than normal effects on the peripheral tissues. What are the peripheral tissues? Muscles, fat and liver. Therefore, it is not properly acting on the peripheral tissues. Thereby, you will see increased glucose levels even with increased insulin levels. This is mainly due to mutations in the insulin receptor gene. This is insulin receptor gene, mainly due to mutations in this receptor or some phosphorylation defect. Generally, insulin goes with tyrosine phosphorylation. If there is serine phosphorylation, again there is increased insulin resistance. Thereby, glucose is increased, and again it will stimulate the pancreas to increase insulin levels. And this increased insulin levels, it will go to ovarian theca cells and it will stimulate the theca cells to produce more androgens. Again, these androgens go to the liver. It will stimulate liver to reduce the sex hormone binding globulin, again increasing free androgens. Free androgens again cause insulin resistance. This is a cycle for insulin resistance in the polycystic ovarian syndrome. It will start with some mutation in receptors of insulin, which leads to insulin resistance and high glucose levels, which stimulate the pancreas to secrete insulin. Again, insulin goes and stimulate the theca cells to secrete androgens. Androgen goes to the liver and decrease the sex hormone binding globulin. Finally, androgen levels are increased. So this is a vicious cycle. So coming to the brief pathology, which we have already said in the previous slides, the hypothalamus, it will have a pulsatile GnRH secretion. With this pulsatility is increased, which stimulates the pituitary with a preferential increase in LH, thereby increase in LH to FSH ratio happens. So this LH goes and it will stimulate the theca cells of ovaries and produce androgens. And this FSH, due to low levels, the follicular growth is arrested at various levels. And there is low levels of estrogens. From adrenal gland, due to stress and due to P450 enzyme dysregulation, again there is a high androgen synthesis. And finally, these androgens will go to adipose tissue and increase E1. E1 is estrone. If you can see in the spelling, O-N-E-1. Estrone is E1 due to peripheral aromatization. And on skin, it have these features like hirsutism, acne, acanthosis, nigricans. And due to adipose tissue, again, obesity results in insulin resistance. Insulin resistance on skin changes goes with acanthosis, nigricans. And again, insulin resistance go to ovarian theca cells to increase androgen secretion and follicle atresia, finally, and ovulation. So this E1 estrone levels are constantly increased and they will act on endometrium of the uterus, finally causing endometric hyperplasia. So the pathophysiology starts with hypothalamus with increased pulse frequency of GnRH, preferential stimulation of LH, and LH goes and stimulate theca cells of ovaries with increased synthesis of androgens, and decreased FSH will lead to arrest of various follicular growth in the ovary, and androgens in peripheral adipose tissue, they will get converted into estrone by peripheral aromatization. And these androgens, they will have other clinical features on skin. When they act on follicular hair follicles, it will cause hirsutism and it will cause acne. Due to insulin resistance, again acanthosis, nigricans, and follicular atresia causing anovulation and amenorrhea, and unopposed estrone. Because there is no ovulation, there is no progesterone secretion, and this estrogen, which is secreted, formed due to peripheral aromatization, will cause stimulation of endometrium of uterus, causing endometrial hyperplasia. So what are the clinical features of PCOS? The menstrual dysfunction is a common clinical feature of PCOS, It may go with amenorrhea or oligomenorrhea. But some patients will manifest with menorrhagia after a prolonged period of amenorrhea. This is due to, as I've already said, this is due to this one, this estrogen. This is due to chronic estrogen exposure, which stimulates the endometrium. And after continuous stimulation of the endometrium, endometrium becomes unstable and it is shed off. So it may begin with menarche, and 50% of postmenarchal girls usually have an irregular periods up to 2 years. So you cannot go with this diagnosis up to 2 years due to immaturity of HPO axis. 50% of postmenarchal girls up to 2 years, they will have irregular cycles. In PCOS, even after 2 years, they will continue with irregular cycles. That is anovulation or oligomenorrhea. Hyperandrogenism usually manifests as hirsutism or acne or androgenic alopecia. Hirsutism, if you can see here, the picture is defined as coarse, dark terminal hairs, which are distributed in male pattern. Usually seen in 70 to 80% of PCOS women, and it develops in late adolescent. Cause is due to increased androgen. Most common areas are upper lip, chin, chest and linea alba of lower abdomen. This occurs due to increased androgen production, either ovarian or adrenaline in origin. This androgens, usually this follicular cells have hair follicles are very sensitive to dihydrotestosterone. This dihydrotestosterone is a product of testosterone when it is acted upon by 5 alpha reductase enzyme. So when you see a patient with hirsutism, there is a scoring called modified Ferriman-Galway scoring. Usually we see 9 areas, these 3: upper lip, chin and thorax, thighs, these are arms, thighs, upper back, lower back, upper abdomen and lower abdomen. These 9 areas are seen in a hirsute woman, and it is graded as 1, 2 and 3, 4. So you have to total all this, and if the range is more than 8, then you will diagnose her as hirsute. The other easy methods are how many times she goes for epilation, or how many times she goes for shaving. You just ask her from the history itself. So hirsutism is hirsutism in 9 androgen sensitive areas. You see, as I've already said, you give a scoring of 1 to 4 and you just total it. If the score is more than 8, then it is hirsute. The second feature of hyperandrogenism is acne. See, frequent clinical findings in adolescent with PCOS. This is also due to androgen excess. The main factors are due to the follicular opening at the gland is blocked due to hyperkeratosis, and due to blockage, there is more amount of sebum production, which is getting accumulated in the duct. And finally, Propionibacterium acnes get infestated in the duct, and finally it causes inflammation and infection, causing acne. This is androgenic alopecia. Usually it is less common in PCOS. If you see this crown, slowly the progressive hair loss is seen with reduced thinning of the crown hair, with preservation of front line of the hair and bitemporal recession. Acanthosis nigricans, it's a cutaneous marker of insulin resistance. You can see, most common sites are back of the neck and axilla, and below the breast, waist and groin regions. They are seen as thick gray-brown velvety flakes. If you can see in this picture, this is due to insulin resistance. Insulin resistance increases insulin levels, hyperinsulinemia, which will stimulate the dermal fibroblast growth factors. So this causes thick gray-brown velvety flakes. Usually 50% in obese PCOS it is seen, at 5 to 10% in normal weight women also. Again, this is nigricans is seen. Infertility. PCOS patients usually have fertility issues due to anovulatory cycles. Because there is no ovulation, there is less chances of her to conceive or of her to become pregnant. even if she becomes pregnant, there is early miscarriages are more common. This is attributed to insulin resistance. Women with PCOS have 2 to 3 fold higher risk of gestational diabetes, pregnancy induced hypertension, preterm birth and perinatal mortality. Generally, they have less chances of becoming pregnant. Even though if they become pregnant, they have a high risk for gestational diabetes, pregnancy induced hypertension, preterm birth and perinatal mortality. The various long-term sequelae are, if PCOS patient usually have impaired glucose tolerance in 30% of patients, and they will go for diabetes mellitus, frank diabetes mellitus in 7% cases. Similar incidence is also seen in adolescent. Both adolescent and adult obese PCOS, if you see, they will have 7% chances of diabetes mellitus and 30% of them go for impaired glucose tolerance. This is mainly due to beta cell dysfunction, which is independent of obesity. The second long-term sequelae is dyslipidemia. 70% of them will have dyslipidemia. Increased low-density lipoproteins, increased triglycerides, decreased high-density lipoproteins. These changes may increase the cardiovascular risk of the patient. 30 to 40-fold higher incidence of obstructive sleep apnea is seen in women with PCOS. It is usually related to central obesity and insulin resistance. If you see, the high risk for diabetes and cardiovascular disease is seen in those patients who have obstructive sleep apnea when you compare with those without sleep apnea. So patients PCOS with obstructive sleep apnea will go for high risk for diabetes and cardiovascular disease. Coming to metabolic syndrome, it is characterized by insulin resistance, obesity, atherogenic dyslipidemia, hypertension, and it is associated with increased risk of cardiovascular disease and type 2 diabetes mellitus. So how you diagnose a metabolic syndrome is, any three of the following, you can see if any three are positive, then you will give her, you will diagnose a case of metabolic syndrome. Waist size of more than 35 inches female, triglycerides of more than 150 milligrams per deciliter, high density lipoproteins of less than 50 milligrams per deciliter, blood pressure of more than 130 by 85 millimeter Hg, fasting glucose of 110 to 126 milligrams per deciliter, and 2-hour glucose, 75 grams oral glucose tolerance test. After 2 hours, if you check, if the range is 140 to 199 milligram per deciliter. If any three are positive, then she is a candidate for metabolic syndrome. And finally, the endometrial hyperplasia. The risk of endometrial cancer is increased in PCOS due to unopposed estrogen action on the endometrium of uterus. This endometrial hyperplasia and cancer are long-term risks of chronic anovulation, and neoplastic changes in the endometrium are felt to rise from chronic unopposed estrogens. And it will impair the psychological health of the women. She'll become more anxious and depressed about the condition because it is a chronic condition, with decreased quality of life and negative body image because of obesity. These are the common symptoms on a gist. Androgenic alopecia, acne, hirsutism are the clinical features of hyperandrogenism. Acanthosis nigricans is due to insulin resistance, which is the brown velvety patches seen on flexure areas like axilla, back of the neck and submammary areas. Central obesity, that is more of abdominal obesity, and amenorrhea, oligomenorrhea with ultrasonogram picture showing polycystic ovaries. These are long-term sequelae: glucose intolerance or frank diabetes mellitus, hyperinsulinemia due to glucose intolerance, hypertension, dyslipidemia, and metabolic syndrome. So what investigations you want to do for this type of patients? On ultrasound, if you see, more than 12 peripherally arranged 2 to 9 mm size of cyst, you can see if it is a polycystic ovarian. But this can be a polycystic ovarian morphology also, it may be functional. If it is associated with other features of hyperandrogenism, then you will diagnose it as PCOS. Either 2 to 9 mm size of cyst of more than 12 in number, or ovarian volume of more than 10 mm. If you see serum LH and FSH ratio, usually LH to FSH ratio is less than or equal to 2:1. Now in PCOS, due to tonic elevation of LH, the ratio is more than 2:1. Raised estrone levels, as I have already said, due to peripheral aromatization. Peripheral aromatization is occurs in adipose tissue. The androgens are getting converted into E1 in the peripheral adipose tissue. If you see the ovarian aromatization, androgens get converted into E2, which is not happening in PCOS. And reduced sex hormone binding globulin, raised androgens. If you check her testosterone levels, usually it is more than 150 nanogram per deciliter, but it is not, it is usually less than 200. It is more than 200, again you should suspect some androgen secreting tumors. Insulin resistance, if you see fasting, if you see her fasting insulin levels, if it is more than 25 micro international units per ml, or fasting glucose by insulin less than 4.5, then you will take it as insulin resistance. So grossly, the ovaries look like this. They become enlarged with ovarian volume of more than 10 ml. The capsule is thickened. You can see this white areas, thickened capsule with multiple follicular cysts. This is normal ovary and this is the polycystic ovary. Ovarian size is getting increased. Capsule is thickened with numerous follicles. Histologically, the thickened tunica albuginea, that is the same capsule. The capsule is thickened. Multiple follicles at various stages get arrested due to low FSH levels, and even they get atretic and even theca cell hyperplasia due to LH stimulation. So after seeing all these symptoms and signs, you have to exclude the other pathological causes. Androgen producing tumors of ovary and late onset congenital adrenal hyperplasia, adrenal tumors, all these cause the hyperandrogenic features which we have already mentioned, that is hirsutism, acne and alopecia. So how you will differentiate this from PCOS? In androgen producing or androgen secreting tumors, usually the testosterone levels will be more than 200 nanograms. In PCOS, it is more than 150 and less than 200. In late onset congenital adrenal hyperplasia, you go with 17 hydroxy progesterone values. If it is more than 200, then it is diagnosed as congenital adrenal hyperplasia, CAH. In adrenaline tumors, usually the DHEAS. DHEAS is dehydroxy epiandrosterone sulfate. That is the androgen which is more specific for adrenaline glands. Therefore, you have to check for DHEAS levels. If it is more than 700, you will go with adrenaline tumors. And ovulation may be a reason, due to hypothyroidism or hyperprolactinemia, which is distinguished by TSH levels and prolactin levels. Serum TSH levels, if it is elevated, you will diagnose it as hypothyroidism. If serum prolactin levels are more than 25 to 30, you will label it as hyperprolactinemia. Exogenous androgen use, you can just rule out from the history itself, because from history itself, you can ask her whether she is taking any androgens from outside. And HCG producing tumors outside the reproductive tract also causes the same picture. With serum HCG levels, you can differentiate it. So finally, after diagnosing, how you will treat the case of PCOS? There is no universal treatment available for a PCOS candidate. Usually treatment is individuals depending on women's need and the severity of the symptoms. The common modalities are conservative, medical and surgical modalities. Generally, first line therapy goes with weight reduction and exercises. Even 5% weight reduction will improve the metabolic syndrome and will improve the reproductive function. That is, it will regularize the cycles, it will regularize the menstrual cycles of the women, and it will improve the reproductive function of the women even with a 5% reduction of the weight. And lifestyle modification, you should advise the patient regarding the healthy diet and exercises. Healthy diet along with exercises. Healthy eating, exercises and losing weight, blood sugar controlling with diet. If it is not happening with diet, add her on insulin sensitizers like metformin. Reducing stress and anxiety, she can go for a yoga or a meditation. anti-inflammatory treatment and eliminating toxins if necessary, and taking necessary vitamins. So conservative treatment, if patient is having a fairly regular cycles, that is from 8 to 12 cycles per year, but if 8 to 12 cycles per year with mild hyperandrogenism, which is not that meant for treatment, then you just encourage her to lose weight and advise her diet modification to reduce high carbohydrate diet and to increase fiber in her diet and to increase fruits and vegetable content in her diet and exercise for 30 minutes every day and at least 5 days per week. And you have to screen the patient for any long-term consequelae like dyslipidemia and diabetes mellitus. So medical management aims to lower the insulin levels and it will restore the regular menstruation, restore fertility and treat hirsutism and acne and prevent endometrial hyperplasia and endometrial cancer. So if any of these if any of these disturbances are there, we'll just add on medical management. So to restore the ovulation, you just start on combined oral contraceptive pills. Usually these combined oral contraceptive pills will have estrogens and progesterones at varied doses. When you give COCs on a regular basis, they will suppress the gonadotropin release, that is FSH and LH get levels are released, and it also reduces the androgen levels. Thereby, it will regularize the menstrual cycles. If patients are if patient is having any side any adverse effects to combined oral contraceptive pill, combined oral contraceptive pills, or COCs are contraindicated in certain patients like migraine, severe hypertension, or age more than 35 years, or any other contraindicated features for COCs, then you go for a cyclical progesterones. So you will give cyclical progesterones, medroxyprogesterone acetate from day you will give from day 15 to 25. Otherwise, if she is not compliant for cyclical progesterones, you just advise her an intrauterine progesterone device. If patient is having an insulin resistance or hyperinsulinemia, you just start her on metformin because it improves the peripheral insulin sensitivity and increases the target tissue sensitivity to insulin, decreases the androgen levels, and helps in spontaneous ovulation. Even thiazolidinedione also improves the entry of glucose into the peripheral tissues and suppresses the hepatic gluconeogenesis. So if the patient is coming, PCOS patient is coming, if she is anxious to conceive, if her cycles are regular, even if she is having a hyperandrogenism with the USG showing PCOS picture, you just start her on clomiphene citrate. This is an ovulation induction drug, either with clomiphene citrate. If she is not conceiving with clomiphene citrate, add her on metformin because this is an insulin sensitizer which will increases the chance of getting pregnant with clomiphene. If this fails, then you go for a gonadotropin, that is FSH alone can be given or along with HCG can be given. If this fails, then artificial assisted reproductive technology can be used. So hyperandrogenism features like hirsutism is treated with combined oral contraceptive pills because it reduces the androgen levels and estrogen component is also increased. Efinornithine hydrochloride is used for removal of hair in hirsute patients. In GnRH agonists and anti-androgens can be used. Anti-androgens like spironolactone, which is given at the dose of 50 to 100 milligrams twice daily, can be given, but it is having a water losing capacity. Even COCs with cyproteine acetate and estrogen can be added. 5-alpha reductase inhibitor, which I have already said, this is the potent enzyme which converts testosterone into dihydrotestosterone, which stimulates the facial hair. Therefore, if you target on this enzyme with finasteride 5 mg daily, it will reduce hirsutism. Or physical methods like depilation and epilation, shaving, waxing can be done. Acne can be, mild acne can be treated with the combined oral contraceptive pills, with low dose pills. If it is moderate to severe, then you will add systemic antibiotics like doxycycline or benzoyl peroxide and topical retinoids. If all this medical management fails, usually previously ovarian wedge resection was done, but now it is rarely done because if you do go for a wedge resection, you will lose the ovarian tissue, which you may need for fertility issues. And oophorectomy is rarely done. When fertility is not desired, then she may go for oophorectomy, but it's not done nowadays. Laparoscopic ovarian drilling by laser or electrocautery or multiple biopsy can be used for medically managed, I mean, resistant cases. It is due to destruction of androgen production because high androgen concentration in the ovaries is reduced by laparoscopic ovarian drilling. So thank you. I hope you understand a bit of PCOS. Any doubts? So we'll leave for today.